Welcome back, advanced painting students. Today we're going to create the brown parts of the underpainting. So you'll need your palette, you'll need some water, your brushes, and some raw umber paint. That's the brown that I gave you. You don't need a lot of paint. And we're going to begin by making a puddle with some water and a little bit of raw umber. And I'm going to test it on here. And we're going to try to put on really thin to start. Should not look too dark. And I'm brushing it on very gently, because the pencil lines that we made last time are vulnerable to getting lifted off by the wet paint. That's why I'm also going right up to my line. If I went over my line, I might lose that edge, which I don't want. Starting with the cast shadow in the background. If you have any artist's fixative or even a really basic hairspray like Aquanet, preferably unscented, you can spray a very light coat of that over your pencil drawing to seal it. You don't have to worry about having it lift up. And now I'm going to go thin coat of brown everywhere it looks to me that the light doesn't reach the ear in this photograph. It's a good idea to start this when you have at least an hour or two to complete it, because I like to do the whole underpainting in one shot. Because while this brown is wet, we can make adjustments very easily. After it dries, we're going to have a hard time. If you want, you can draw some of these details in. Like, I really probably should have drawn this little shadow edge right here. You see where the light ends there? And then this shadow kind of climbs up around this edge like that. This is all in shadow. And notice I sort of screwed up a little because I threw some brown right on top of
the tragus.
But I can just use a wet brush and lift it off. You want to think about this as almost like working on a whiteboard. In a few minutes, we're going to zoom in with a smaller brush and do some detail work. But right now, we're just broadly sketching in these shadows. Here's another one that I really could have drawn in before, but didn't. There's nothing wrong even with doing a little shading with pencil first before you start this stage, or if you're in the middle of this stage and you start to get a little confused, you can get your pencil out and sort of mark some more for some of your shadow edges. Also, when you're painting, you may notice in a few areas that your outlines aren't quite in the right place, and you should feel free to use every stage of this process to make your drawing better. Now, where your edges need to be a little softer, you can just take a damp brush and sort of pounce along the edge. It doesn't have to be blended, it just has to be sort of roughened a little so it doesn't look like too sharp. remember, the water that I'm thinning the paint with is a solvent that's going to be evaporating very quickly. But the binder of the paint, the oil, is going to stay wet for several hours. Raw umber is a relatively fast drying paint, so I can't wait too long, but it will stay wet for a good while. So now, because this layer of paint here is wet, I can start pulling darker darks in along my edges. So I'm just picking up slightly more concentrated paint. And paying attention along every edge to which side of the edge is darker. For example, along here the wall is darker than the cast. So I'm going to go in and darken the wall. And then I need to kind of spread my dark down into that cast shadow. I'm working on a tabletop. I'm standing up, looking down on the painting, which is not ideal, but it's the easiest way for me to record what I'm doing. You could use an easel if you have one, or prop the painting up against a pile of books. And I'm just still working very broadly. I'm just trying to get darkest darks, the big ones, in there. Still not too worried about fine details. Here, we're going to zoom in a little. This is the first place where I'm going to try to show the effect of reflected light. You'll notice along this bottom edge of this curved form, we have a little bit of light that's bouncing off of the helix. So I want to show that edge in the painting exactly the way we see it in the photograph. That means taking some darker brown right through here and create nice crisp edge along the pencil line. I got a little too much water in the paint there. I just need to wait a second for that to evaporate. I also see some darker darks right down in here and along this edge. Now I'm going to use this smaller brush. It doesn't have any paint on it. It's totally dry. I'm just going to use it to fine-tune some of these edges. And the key thing here is just to try to paint exactly what you see. I'm picking up a little paint on this brush and darkening above the reflected light. This is called the core shadow. It's between the cast shadow down here and the reflected light. And usually when beginners feel that their reflected lights aren't bright enough, and some of them even put white into them, it's because their core shadows aren't dark enough. They just don't think about putting any dark up here above the reflected light. But notice, as soon as you put that in, it really creates an illusion that this form is turning under. Notice I'm just picking away at this with these small strokes. There's even a little bit of reflected light right in here, so and darken that core shadow a little more and darken underneath, and that's what's going to make it look like this form is sticking out from the canvas. Zoom out here a little bit. Notice we have a similar situation up here. We've got this really dark cast shadow. Up above it, we've got a fairly bright reflected light, and we're going to bring that out by adding a dark core shadow. Remember to have a paper towel in one hand to keep drying your brush as necessary and wiping the extra paint off. one reason I picked an ear for us to paint is because ears come in a lot of different shapes and sizes, so hopefully you can make some pretty major mistakes in your painting and it's still going to look like an ear. So now that these little hatching marks I've made have had a chance to evaporate a little bit, I can just very gently brush across them, make it look a little less spotty, even darkening my reflected light a little bit, so it's standing out a little too much. This only works if your brush is fairly clean and dry. But we call this unifying the shadows. The reflected lights are too prominent. Don't make the mistake of thinking that we need to use brown or raw umber anywhere up here. This is all in full light, so we're going to leave that alone. Because remember, our canvas is already not white. It's already at middle value, so all those little changes are going to come out once we start using white on this. Now, if you get to a point where you need to stop, but you haven't completed the painting, the underpainting, to your satisfaction, just make sure you haven't put in anything too dark. You can always add more brown after it's dry, but you can't really take it away very easily, so. If you need to take a long break, just lift off some of the really dark areas with a damp brush. Some painters create incredibly finished looking underpaintings. And some painters create underpaintings that are just very, very loose. And we're going to do something in between. Not too finished and not too loose. Notice we don't have much, if any, reflected light on this curve over here because there's nothing nearby to reflect light. So this just goes dark right up to the edge. And we're going to be done here before we know it. Notice that I'm using a lot of kind of back and forth hatching motion as I paint. Notice also that I'm left-handed, so the most natural movement that my hand makes is going this way. If you're right-handed, you should probably be going the other way like that. That's something we talk a lot about in drawing class, but I'm aware that not all of you have taken that class. So that was a little too dark. I'm just going to take my bigger brush and just spread it around. Got just a little tiny bit of reflected light hitting the bottom of the earlobe. So to show that, I'm going to go really dark in here. And then slightly darker shadow above it. Again, using my detail brush. When I want to create a really sharp edge, like along here, notice I'm going to move my brush along the edge. You didn't see that, did you? Right along here. Moving with the edge. I want to soften an edge. I'm going to shade into it like that. I just noticed another little drawing mistake. This shadow edge here is climbing a little too high. That was something I did in the first phase of this project. But again, it's just like a whiteboard. I can use a wet brush and just push that down. Now, if I hadn't been able to make that correction, it wouldn't have been the end of the world. But if you see something that's obviously wrong and the paint's still wet, then you may as well correct it. Here again, this reflected light is standing out too much, so I'm going to just gently sweep my brush right across that edge. also down here it's coming out. It's way too strong of an edge, so I just shade right over it and push it back. Another little drawing correction. I'm going to bring this edge of the earlobe up a little. And I'm going to go much darker on the wall now. Every edge to stand out in your painting just about as strongly as it stands out in the photograph. No less and no more. I'm going to throw one more coat of a much darker brown on this wall. That looked dark enough when I first did it. Notice that having done some of the accents inside the ear, the wall looks much too bright. And now I can see I need to get a little more of this dark right along here. A little bit of a core shadow through here. And then a core shadow starts here and goes all the way down and connects with this one. Finally, I'm going to wipe off my brush and just sweep along this edge to soften it. And throw a little dark right in here. Remember, these are not our final values. This whole thing should look like a slightly paler and less detailed version of the photograph. And that's about it for this stage of the process. Sometimes I do the white part of the underpainting as soon as I finish the raw umber, but I'm going to suggest that you let this dry for a day or two, and I'm going to do the same, because that way we won't risk the raw umber and the white blending together anywhere. So we're going to leave it right there. Thanks a lot. I'm going to upload a picture of my painting at this stage to Canvas as well, and also the original photograph, so you can use those as references.